Okay, Slayer, so I just realized I've been pronouncing his name wrong this whole time, so you don't have to tell me in the comments. I still don't know how to pronounce it, and I always said Antonio, but I guess that's not it. I'm so sorry. Hey Slayers, and welcome to Antonio Senna's Super Monaco GP2, 1992 Sega. Now, obviously, this game was designed by Antonio Senna. Now, first off, I want to say this real quick, because I'm going to be kind of discreet in this episode about what I talk about and what I don't talk about, because mostly I want to do this. This is one that definitely deserves its own Sega history episode, and will be getting one when the series returns, probably in Season 2. It will be getting one for sure one day, so I want to be careful about what I actually tell you and don't tell you in this episode, because I don't want to go into too much detail and just spoil the whole Sega history episode before it even gets made. Second off, I probably should have done this video a long time ago when I first looked at it. And another thing, third off, I'm not really into F1 cars, so if I sound like I don't know what I'm talking about, it's probably because I don't. From what I know, Antonio Senna was or still is a famous F1 driver, you know what I'm saying? Won the world championship multiple times. And I had learned a lot about it a while ago, but then I kind of forgot it all. Really, I know, the world's coolest second enthusiast, I know. But anyway, you start off, and this game is very similar to Super Monaco GP1, right? And the fact that you have the Senna GP, or Senna Grand Cup, or Grand Prix, right? World Championship, free practice, and then options. We can just take a look at the options real quick. You can type A, you can have your language set to Japanese or English, your meter, you know what I'm saying? Nothing simple. The voice effects. Well, I just realized you can't hear it, but I think these were done by Antonio Senna himself. Sorry, he's from Brazil. I can't pronounce his name right sometimes. It's stupid. I don't know why. But we'll just go with the simple track right here. This is Brazil, my home country. I actually designed this course for go-karts. I'm looking forward to the day when one of the children who drives here becomes the world champion. We'll just go with automatic speed real fast. And the first thing you'll notice is it's just like Super Monaco GP1, and well, okay, I'm driving, I'm gonna lose. It's just like Super Monaco GP1, and you know I did a whole video about Super Monaco GP1 classic title. This one is classic too. Still though, for some reason a lot less people know about this one than they know about the original one, and I don't know why that is. From what I know, this one was pretty popular back in the day. Maybe it's because I think it has a lot to do with the original title being like almost a launch title for the Genesis, and this coming out in 92, so it was kind of overshadowed by a lot of other bigger games, which, you know what I'm saying? I'm not gonna say F1 racing is a very niche sport anyway, but at least here in the US it is a very niche sport. I don't hear too much about it, you know what I'm saying? I forgot there's flashing lights in this game. When it comes to like racing games, did I already lose? I already lost? Oh my god, I'm that bad? Oh wait, no, maybe I didn't lose. Maybe that was just a test and I didn't lose yet. Yeah, but when it comes to, at least from what I know, F1 racing here in the US, it's a very niche thing. It's not one of those things you hear about every day, you know what I'm saying? More people, when it comes to racing here in the US, that's pretty much all dominated by like something like NASCAR. And then you got other bigger sports like football, baseball, basketball, and all that. So you don't hear too much about F1 racing. But from in other parts of the world, especially I think Europe and South America, F1 racing is huge. So as you can guess, this game did pretty freaking well in those two markets. I don't know about in Japan. I know it did also come out in Japan, but I don't know how it did in Japan. I know it did. I know for a fact it did extremely well in Japan. I mean, in Brazil and Europe. But as far as here in America, I don't think it did that well, especially compared to the first one. And because I don't think this one, from what I know, should have had a huge budget, which it did have a huge budget. And I want to be careful, like I said, about what I say about the game. As far as the gameplay goes itself, it's pretty much Super Monaco GP1, although a little bit more refined. I got the controls, they feel better here, they feel more tight, you know what I'm saying? More, it's like they refined the gameplay here. The sound, it sounds a lot better than the first one. The music here is also really good, just like the first one, I think better. First off, obviously the graphics are a little bit smoother than what the first one would be. At least from my perspective, they gave you a better field of vision, you know what I'm saying? You get more screen room than what you would get, and I crashed. You get more screen room than what you would get, and we'll take a look at this track. You get more I always hit back. Hold on, actually, we'll just take a free practice match. You get more screen room in this version than you would get with, like, just take, for example, the first game, or even something like OutRun. If you remember OutRun, OutRunners, you get terrible field of view in that game, and it's just kind of hard to play. In this game, you get a bigger field of view, and I think that's perfect, because, you know, what fun is it if you don't have a good field of view? And I already crashed. Am I that bad? I didn't. Since when? When have I been that bad? Okay, listen. Okay, I shouldn't be this bad. Why am I this bad? I'm embarrassing myself. Listen, you get a bigger field of view here than what you would get on something like OutRunners and all that. Games that came out way later, and I appreciate that, you know what I'm saying? I always loved it. Although I think what would have been cool from the time for the time is if you would have had a third person view. Although personally, I always liked driving games in first person anyway. But a lot of people didn't like that, and I know there were some other racers out there that did first person at the time. But as far as like F1 goes, I can't really tell you how this would stack up against some of the other titles from the time, just because, like I said, F1 isn't really that popular here in the U.S. So when you look at something like this, you have to ask yourself, well, hey, is it entirely accurate to the courses? Is it entirely accurate to the likenesses? And yeah, from what I know, Antonio Senna himself sat there and literally watched over this game extremely like a hawk. Literally, he was basically the guy who almost designed it by himself, you would think, because he was there. He was like, dude, he was there. He was making sure his game was good regardless, you know what I'm saying? So with that being said, I'm gonna guess this is pretty accurate to, you know, everything you would come to expect from an F1 game. After all, he was literally sitting there supervising it. And you know, usually people don't like licensed games, but this one usually gets a good rap when I do hear about it. Like I said, I don't hear about it too often, but when I do hear about it, it's always super interesting, because you know, this game here has an actual great story behind it. And like I said, I really can't wait to tell that story when I actually do get around to it on Sega History, when Sega History returns next year. I can't wait to tell the story of the game itself, because it has an awesome story. Even more legendary than the game itself, I would say the story is. When you hear about it, you're just not going to be able to believe it, and I love that so much about it. And why are the buttons reversed? No, they are not. I'm just stupid, and I have my buttons set to, I have my buttons. This course reminds me of Monaco with its tunnels and narrow track with no escape areas. However, there are several points where you can improve your position. The constant cornering, especially the long left curve in the first half of the course, will literally leave you with a pain in the neck. Literally. Yeah, you also get those little quotes there from him. As you can see, this is the hilly region of Australia. Austria, right? No, Austria, not Australia. The course is lined with beautiful trees. Lots of ascents and descents require the use of a powerful engine because there are many straightaways and turns. Use the slipstream to your advantage. See, I'm kind of looking far away. That's why I was reading like that. But yeah. Oh, no, I think the courses are good. I think the graphics are a huge improvement over the first game. The first game's graphics are good. They're just not as good as this. Like, obviously, this was 92, you know what I'm saying? But I do think as far as, like, 3D racers go on the Genesis, while this one is this is definitely top choice right here. If you're not in the F1, it really won't like be your cup of tea. Like, I have a huge appreciation for the Super Monaco series, but I'm not gonna lie, I don't revisit it that often, just because, like I said, F1 isn't really that big here, and even if it was, I really probably wouldn't even be that much of a fan. You don't hear about F1 here, at least in the US, at least nowadays, you know what I'm saying? Maybe it was different back in the day, maybe it was going on a rise in the 90s, but at least now you don't really hear about F1, and I don't really hear too much about these games. So it's like, when I'm going back to play my Genesis races, I'm going back to play something like Super Hang On, OutRun, you know, OutRun 2019, you know what I'm saying? and all games like that. Obviously the Road Rash series, but this on its own though is a totally fun series, and I totally recommend you check it out. Totally recommend you check this game out. I totally recommend you check the first game out. They're both super fun and interesting titles, especially with the story behind this game. It's extremely interesting, so I definitely recommend you check this game out, if not just to experience a piece of the awesome history that is Antonio Senna's Super Monaco GP2. It's like, I don't know why you don't hear about it too much. It's just, you hear about it, but like when you do hear about it, it's very brought up. Really, when the game only gets mentioned, it gets mentioned for its story, and that's just not fair. This game is worth a lot more than just the story it is, you know what I'm saying? Don't get me wrong, the story is awesome, and I love hearing all about this game, and I can't wait to tell the story myself. Well, as far as the game goes, it's an awesome game, and I totally think it deserves more praise than what it gets. Even from me, I think I should start giving this game a little bit more praise than what it gets. Now, there is only three tracks, you know what I'm saying? But still, even then, the tracks are fun. They have a huge learning curve, so they don't have a huge learning curve. I mean, they have a learning curve, so it's fun when you actually are able to master the tracks and come in first. I'm not going to be able to do it because I suck at the game, but if for someone who's actually super good at Super Monaco GP, you can master these tracks and have an actual blast on the game. Now, I'm gonna go ahead and end this review here. Totally check it out. 10 out of 10, Super Monaco GP2, Antonio Senna's Super Monaco GP2. I think the game's worth more than the story, and if you just heard the story in this game and you've never played it, definitely go out and try it, you know what I'm saying? Now, I'm going to let you know now before we get to prices. I already know they're super expensive, but still, I still think this game is worth a look. Anyway, you got to look at it, whether you get it off a collection, whether you got to emulate it, or if you are a perfectionist, buy a real copy, you know what I'm saying? But as far as prices goes, they're going to be pretty high. 10 out of 10, definitely recommend you try this game. I'll be back in 1 second with prices, okay? I'm going to tell you something, man. This game is a lot less money than I thought it would be. Not even gonna lie. I love the box art, by the way. It's classic. It's some awesome box art. I love that, man. You know what I'm saying? I love Genesis celebrity games. You know what I'm saying? Some were good. Others were bad. You know what I'm saying? Compared, like Super Monaco GP2, total classic. James Buster Douglas Boxing, not so much. You know what I'm saying? So they were all hit or miss. And Michael Jackson's Moonwalker, totally awesome. I'm trying to think of another bad celebrity Genesis game. But other than James Buster Douglas Boxing. But anyway, that's not the point of this video. We'll talk about that another day. For right now, a loose copy is going to run you around $10, and it receives around one sale per week, which is actually pretty freaking good. A complete price is going to run you around $15.75, and it also receives around one sale per week, which is also extremely good. A new copy is going to run you around $47 and receives around one sale per year, which is, you know, pretty good. Actually, no, it's really good, because I was thinking you were going to freaking show historic prices. What does that mean? Is that how much it used to cost? Oh, no, this is just how much it always went for. Okay. Yeah, that's cool. But you know what I'm saying? I thought this game was going to be extremely expensive. So for a loose copy on Amazon, you're looking to pay around $4.48. eBay, you're going to be looking to pay around $6.25. For a complete price, eBay, you're going to be looking to pay around $1.72. And Amazon, you're going to be looking to pay around $1.71. Which is not really true, because for a new price on Amazon, you're going to be looking to pay around $171. And then it says no one else has it, but I guarantee you, just look on eBay, you'll find it, no problem. You know what I'm saying? It says no release date. It has a release date. Sega, obviously, publisher. Probably even the developer, too. It's one player, you know what I'm saying? It's just a one-player game, three courses. Fun. Totally recommend the game. And like I said, I think the game itself needs more praise, not just the story. Like I said, at the end of the day, the story is a totally interesting story. It's extremely interesting from how the game came to be, from Antonio Senna's rise as a F1 racer and all that. It's and I watched a very good documentary on it. What was it? Maybe a year ago, last year, maybe early this year. It was either early this year or last year, and it was really good. And I was gonna put it in the link in the description, but I don't really know where it's at anymore. But I watched a really good, like, hour-long documentary all about this game, and it started out with Antonio Senna's whole, like, life story, bring up and all that. It was extremely good. You know what I'm saying? It was an extremely good documentary. So if I can find it, I'll put it in the link to the description. If I can't, it probably won't be there. But anyway, this game deserves more praise than what the story gets. I mean, the story is awesome, but the game also is awesome too, and I think more people need to try it. So if you got the time, go out and try this game. It's a totally fun experience. I'm telling you, you won't regret it. It's totally worth your time. But anyway, if you're new here, if you could subscribe, that'd be really awesome. We're trying to reach 200 subscribers, and you'd be helping us out a lot. Make sure to share this video with your friends to become a super slayer. I've been the world's coolest second enthusiast, Sega Slayer 64. And until next time, remember, check out Super Monaco GP2. Total fun title. Totally recommend. The story is great, and the game is great too. Have a good one, slayers.